Hello everyone, I am Santosh Baligar. Today we will go further and cover our topics for Extraordinary General Meeting. So the three sections that we will be covering today, the most important of that would be section 100, which would cover Extraordinary General Meeting. Along with that, an ancillary provision would be section 98. And finally, we will conclude this lecture with section 99. So these are the three sections that we will go through. Without wasting any time, let us move ahead into the provisions. So we had covered up to AGM, which is a type of general meeting. The another type of general meeting other than AGM is EGM. EGM means Extraordinary General Meeting. Annual General Meeting is a meeting where the company meets once in a year. But during the year, there will be many decisions that the company would have to take, for which shareholders' approval is required, and the company cannot wait till the annual general meeting. Hence, the board of directors of the company have been authorized by the Companies Act to call for an extraordinary general meeting to conduct such business. So, the first point is that extraordinary general meeting is a meeting other than annual general meeting. And any meeting that is held between two annual general meetings is known as extraordinary general meeting. So any meeting of shareholders which is held between two AGM is extraordinary general meeting. That's point number one. Second point, who can call for an extraordinary general meeting? Like in my introduction, I told you that the board of directors of the company are authorized to call for an extraordinary general meeting. So, the board of directors, suo moto means on their own, whenever it deems fit. It's a pretty simple one. Board of directors. Who can call extraordinary general meeting? It is a board of directors. But there are variations in this. Apart from the board of directors, suo moto calling an extraordinary general meeting, it is also possible sometimes that the members would require a meeting to be held. And hence, board of directors have been authorized to call for a meeting in the nature of EGM, whenever they get a requisition from the members. So board of directors shall call an EGM on requisition of members. Which type of members is what we will go through in this particular slide itself. But the important point over here is that even if the members want to call for an EGM, they'll have to first go through the board of directors, and board of directors on receipt of a requisition from the members do not have a choice. They shall call for an EGM. They may nahi bola hai yahan pe, it has been said they shall call for an EGM on the requisition of which type of members. If the company is having a share capital, company may be a company having a share capital or a company not having a share capital. Company not having a share capital as in a company which is limited by guarantee. But mostly most of the companies have share capital. And if a company has a share capital, then what is the eligibility? One single member can come up. Or what is the criteria which has been fixed by Companies Act? That is given over here under section 100. subsection 2. So the requisition can be made in case the company is having a share capital by such number of members who hold on the date of requisition at least how much? 1/10 of what paid up share capital. So if the members, number of members hold at least 1/10 of the paid up share capital, which carries voting rights, differential voting rights, nahi, which carries ordinary voting rights. In that case, they can file and requisition with the board of directors of the company. That is one option in case of company having share capital. Now, if a company is not having a share capital, that means it is a guarantee company. In that case, not having a share capital, in that case, such number of members who hold on the date of requisition at least 1/10 of the total voting power. At least 1/10 of the total voting power. Over here, they do not have paid up capital, and hence what would replace paid up capital over here is voting power. Okay? So, 1/10 remains the same in both, with company having share capital or not having share capital. Only thing which will change is because a company does not have a paid up share capital, total voting power will be considered. I hope this is clear to all of you. The requisition that is given by the members under section 100 subsection 2 shall set out the matters for consideration. That means the requisition should set out or clarify what are the business items on which this meeting is being called and what has to be considered in the meeting. Now, note very, very carefully over here that only the matters for consideration have to be listed. The justification or an explanatory statement is not required in such requisition. When the board sends a notice in a suo motu meeting for a special resolution that needs to be passed, an explanatory statement has to be attached. But in case of requisition, explanatory statement is not required. Okay. Second point over here is the requisition shall be signed by the requisitionists. So who the number of members who are making the request shall sign the requisition. And it shall be sent to the registered office of the company where the board of directors would be available. Okay, that is point number two. Point number three, once the requisition is deposited at the registered office of the company, okay, the requisition, once it is deposited at the registered office of the company, then the board shall proceed to call the meeting. The board shall proceed to call the meeting within 21 days of receiving the requisition. So board on receipt of the requisition has time till 21 days to proceed with the convening of the meeting. That is, the board shall send the notice for the meeting within 21 days of receiving the requisition. That's a very important point over here. The second point to the same procedure is that the board shall ensure that the meeting is conducted. Process is started within 21 days, but the meeting shall be conducted within 45 days. The meeting shall be held within 45 days of receiving of requisition. So this whole process over here shall be completed within 45 days. Is it clear? I hope it is. Now, the next provision speaks about section 100 subsection 4, where the requisitionists are calling the AGM and they will be filing the requisition with the board of directors at the registered office of the company. The board of directors shall call for the meeting within 45 days of the receipt of requisition. This is clear to us. from the last slide that we had gone through. Now, in case the board fails to call for a meeting, that is 45 days, within 45 days, the board should have held the meeting. But in case they fail to call the meeting, for whatever reasons it may be, within the specified time limit, then the requisitionist can themselves call the EGM. The requisitionist can themselves call the EGM within 3 months of the valid requisition. Within 3 months of the valid requisition. So over here, the requisitionist will also get a right to call for the EGM themselves, but only in the scenario where the board fails to call for a meeting within the specified time limit. I hope this is clear to you. Let me put this into chart once again, and it will be very clear to you then. The requisition is deposited in the registered office of the company. This is what we did in the last slide. Again, the company shall within 21 days start the process of the meeting, and within 45 days shall hold the meeting. This is clear. Now, if the company fails to call for the meeting, the requisitionist can call the AGM within 3 months of the valid requisition. That is, 3 months would start from the date when the requisition is actually deposited. So in case the board has not initiated the process within 21 days, then the requisitionist can proceed to call the AGM. Okay, and this whole procedure shall be completed by the requisitionist by holding the AGM within 3 months. I hope this is clear. Let us understand the rules which have been given for calling an AGM by requisitionist. This specific rule that we have to do is rule number 17. Now, what does this rule say? This rule says the members may give requisition as per section 100 subsection 4 in writing or through electronic mode at least 21 clear days prior to the proposed date of such AGM. At least 21 days prior to the proposed date, the requisition shall be given by the members under section 100 subsection 4. We will come to this period of notice in more detail in our further lecture, where I would be covering the notice condition also. And the notice shall specify the place, date, day, hour, and contain the business to be transacted at the meeting. Okay. Next. If the resolution is proposed as a special resolution, then as I had confirmed in the previous slides, no explanatory statement would be required. They may give reasons, but an explanatory statement is not required. Okay. Next, the notice shall be signed by the requisitionist or by duly authorized requisitionist in writing. Either the requisitionist themselves sign it or any duly authorized requisitionist. If they say there are 100 requisitionists, out of them they authorize one particular person on their behalf to sign the requisition. That is also possible. And such a notice shall be sent through electronic request. If it is an electronic request, then it shall attach the scanned copy of the duly signed requisition. Okay, these are rules. We learned the provisions. What are the provisions saying of Companies Act? And these are the rules which have been put in place by the central government. Okay. So this one is also clear. The next one says the notice of the meeting shall be given to those members whose names appear in the register of members. Obviously, who are going to attend the meeting? This is, remember the basics. It is a general meeting. General meeting means meeting of shareholders. Shareholders' details are given in which register? The register of members. Okay. and hence the names which are appearing in the register of members, such members will be given the notice. Okay, and what is the cutoff date shall be taken for taking the list of members to whom the notice has to be sent? That is given over here as within 3 days of the requisitionist depositing the valid requisition. That means 3 days from the deposit of the requisition. Within 3 days of the deposit of the requisition, whosoever member's name is there on the register of members, they will have to be sent a notice of the AGM. Clear? Next, the meeting called by the requisitionist shall be held. Where shall it be held? Held at the registered office or in the same town, village, city wherein the registered office is situated. So the meeting called by requisition shall be held at the registered office or in the same town, village or city wherein the registered office is situated. Now there is one scenario which can play out over here. See, the board of directors had not called for this meeting. In case the board of directors had not called for the meeting, then in that case, the requisitionist will still have to hold the meeting in the registered office or in the same town, village or city. In case it is a registered office, and when they go for the meeting, they find out that the gates of the registered office are closed and they are not allowed inside. In that case, they can hold the meeting at any other place other than the registered office also. This was settled through a case law. So remember this point also. Going forward, such meeting should be convened on any day except on national holiday. Okay, so on national holidays, you would not have an AGM held. AGM, which is called by requisitionist. Okay, now the next point says where the meeting is not convened, that is, the board does not convene the meeting, the requisitionist shall have the right to receive the list of members together with the registered address so that they can send the notice. And the number of shares held is on 21st day from the date of receipt of the requisition. See, the board had 21 days to complete their process, but they have not completed their process till the 21st day. Then in that case, the board is liable, or the board shall provide the requisitionists with the list of members and the registered address and number of shares. Number of shares is required so that what is their voting power with each and every member, that has to be ascertained together with such changes before the expiry of 45 days. So if there is any addition or somebody has sold his share, somebody is not a member now, those details shall also be provided by the board, which shall happen within the 45 days from the date of requisition of, from the date of deposit of requisition. Okay, I hope these points are clear to you. They're very simple points. Go through it once. Remember the main points over here. The last point over here is notice shall be sent through speed post or registered post or e-mode. One important point over here is any accidental omission. See, notice is something that is that lends validity to the meeting. Without notice, if a notice is not sent to even one member who was entitled to attend the meeting, then the meeting will get void. Okay, but this is an exception that has been provided in this case, that any accidental omission, that is, it is not an incidental omission, or to give the notice, or the non-receipt of notice by the member. Member himself has not received the notice, although we had done all required steps had been taken by the company or the requisitionist. Then in such scenario, that is accidental omission or non-receipt of notice by the member, it shall not invalidate the meeting. This is an important point for you to know. In case a case study comes, this may be one of the questions that is there in that case study. Okay. So this brings us to the end of section 100. So we are through with section 100. Okay. Section 100, there are three scenarios which we have played out. First is suo moto, the board may call. Second is board shall call on the requisition by the members. Third is If the on the requisition, the board does not call, board does not convene the meeting, in that case, the requisitioners can themselves call the meeting within 3 months from the date of deposit of the requisition. I hope these concepts are extremely clear to you. Now, I'm coming to section 98. This is the fourth scenario that I was saying. Three scenarios are clear. There is another fourth scenario over here, where the power is given to the tribunal. Power is given to the tribunal. Tribunal means NCLT, National Company Law Tribunal. Okay. Now, in this case, if for any reasons it is impracticable, it is not possible to call a meeting other than AGM. Other than AGM means EGM. In any manner that is prescribed by this act or articles of the company. That whatever the rules are given in the act, whatever the provisions are given in the act or in the articles, you cannot call a meeting following those provisions or articles currently due to some reason, some scenario has played out. In that case, there is a power given to the tribunal to call for such meeting. In that case, the tribunal may again suo motu. Suo motu means what? On its own. Or on the application, by whom? A director or a member of the company who would be entitled to vote at the meeting. What can the tribunal do over here? The tribunal may either order for the meeting to be called, held, and conducted in a manner as the tribunal thinks fit. And the tribunal may also give ancillary or consequential directions as to how the meeting shall be held, as to how, what would be the rules or directions, may also modify or supplement the provisions of the act or articles of the company. So, simple thing is that in case for any reason it is impracticable to call for a meeting, then tribunal may suo motu or on the application of director or member order for the meeting to be held and pass such ancillary or consequential directions. I hope this is clear. One important note over here is that, again, the same note as that as it was there in section 97, where the power was given to tribunal for calling of AGM. Over here, it is calling of AGM, which is covered under section 98. Now, same directions. Directions may include that one member present in the meeting in person or proxy shall be deemed to constitute a meeting. And such meeting shall be deemed to be duly called, held, and conducted. I hope this point is clear because we had already discussed this in the AGM lecture. If I explain the same section 98 in chart, if it is impracticable to call for a meeting other than AGM, tribunal may suo motu or on application of any director or member. Now, one thing you have to remember over here, section 97 had given an power of application only to the member, not to the director. But section 98 gives the power to director as well as the member. Okay. Now, tribunal may what? Tribunal may order for the meeting, or tribunal may give, and tribunal may give ancillary or consequential directions. Such directions shall include directions modifying or supplementing. With respect to calling, holding, and conducting of meeting, the operations of provisions of this act or articles of the company. That is, it can modify, and the technical problem which was there to hold the meeting can be modified or supplemented by such directions of the tribunal. Such meeting called shall be deemed duly called, held, and conducted. I hope this is clear. So that basically concludes our section 100 and section 98, which are interrelated. So the four scenarios, that is board suo motu, on requisition, requisitionist themselves, and tribunal who may call the AGM, has been completed. Now there is one more small section, which is that section 99, which is for punishment in default in complying with section 96 to 98. Section 96 is annual general meeting. Section 97 is power of tribunal to call for an AGM, and section 98 is power of tribunal to call for an AGM. In this cases, if the company defaults in complying with the order of the tribunal, or the company contravenes the provisions of the section 96, in that case, the company and the officer in default shall be punishable with fine up to 1 lakh rupees. Okay, and further fine of continuing default will be up to 5,000 rupees every day. Okay, I hope this provision is also clear to you. So this brings us to the end of this lecture today, and we have now completed up to section 100. I would be bringing the rest of the provisions also very soon. Stay tuned to the channel. Please subscribe to the channel. Like the video if you have liked what I have taught over here, and share it with as many friends as possible. Thanks a lot.